Good morning. It is good to be in God's house together, a place where everyone is welcome. We welcome dear friends, neighbors, and all who are joining us by way of our online DVDs. And thank you for being here today. In time, I hope that we can fill this house without restriction with all who seek our God. And again, I do want to thank you for your continuing support and words of encouragement. Even though these are uncharted waters, I think we've done well and we've had a lot of cooperation, and we thank you so very much. Please take a look at the events coming up this week and note the days and times of the drop-off for our yard sale. And then, of course, some of our usual activities. We have had to at least rename one of our groups, the Mask Chancel Handbell Choir. But the French spelling is just so much more continental, shall we say. And then a great treat coming up on Saturday from 6:30 to 7:30, trunk or treat. I don't need a trunk, and I certainly don't need the treats, but I'm going to be there giving them out anyway. And it's been recommended that perhaps you pre-package the candy in bags or something like that, but I'll leave that up to you, and I hope our children have a wonderful, great time with that. As a reminder, at the end of this service today, we will convene our called church conference, which will be our regular fall conference. It will be a shortened agenda. If you have a copy of the conference report and you open it up to the agenda, you said, my goodness, we're going to be here till supper. That's not so. It's going to be a very short, with only two items on the agenda. And for those of you who are not members of our church yet, or if you're a visitor with us today, we will certainly give you an opportunity to depart if you wish, but we certainly welcome everyone to stay for that. We're blessed with the flowers on the altar, on the pedestal today, have been given in loving memory of Joseph and Ellen Louise Pierce and Dr. J. Michael and Margaret Nemish, and they're given by the family, and we thank them so very, very much. As you are able, I invite you to stand as we sing my tribute.
Join me in the call to worship. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely. And let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer, perfecter of our faith. Amen.
Thank you.
Our Father, as we gather here in your house on this Sunday that we commemorate and celebrate the Reformation of the Church, we pray that you would help us to always be on the lookout for ways that we can improve who we are, what we are, and the ways that we reach out to your people here on earth. All praise and honor we bring to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, praying this in the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior, praying together as he taught us, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Our mission moment each Sunday, of course, is a time that we focus on the outreach of the church. Our special missions emphasis for October has been the night stay, the CAPS night stay program, and for the month of November, being that that's Thanksgiving and we think of meals and so forth, it will be Meals on Wheels. I will not ask today, because I think probably the next couple of Sundays we'll be asking this, let's go ahead and ask. How many of you are involved now or earlier as a volunteer with Meals on Wheels? Well, I remember, I don't remember much, but the things I remember are really good. When our church decided to get involved officially as a church, some of our members were already with Meals on Wheels, Haywood Briggs and I made the first Friday delivery, and that was, I guess, 25 or 24 years ago. I had never been up to the north of Suffolk and across Crittenden Road, and of course he knew it like the back of his hand. I was driving, and if he wasn't in the car, I might still be up there. it has been a wonderful, wonderful opportunity. I also want to say one thing. I like to tell this story periodically. Some years back, I was sitting in a Sunday school class, and the subject of foreign missions came up. And one of the students raised a question that I had never thought about before. The question was, how do we know that Christianity is what the people in other lands like that really need? They have their own cultures and probably in most cases their own religions. Well, I kind of had to really reach down deeply and think about that. And really what I responded to by saying was, that's not the question we need to answer. We just go tell the story. And if it's appropriate to them, the Holy Spirit seals it to their hearts. And if not, at least we've made friends and we go away in a friendly fashion. So that's what witnessing is all about. Simply telling who we are, what we are, and then let God take charge of all the rest. Would you please join with me in our unison offertory prayer? Generous and holy God, every good and perfect gift does indeed come from above, provided through your gracious and boundless love. We bring you these gifts, a small portion of what we have received by your hand, and join them with others that we might be found to be doers of the word and not hearers only. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Do I have an announcer? Did you hear that? It's time for the Lamb's Club. Good morning, Lamb's Club. Are they this quiet at home? I see heads going this way. Well, good morning. Oh, we got two more lambs that might be able to come on over. Well, today, here's Lucy Lamb, and she's got her fall mask on. Very, very chic and up with the times. All right, come on in. We always have room for more lambs. If you remember, oh, one more thing. What does the Lamb's Club stand for? Living as my Bible says. Lambs, living as my Bible says. And what does your... What does the Bible say how you should live? Be kind. Be kind. We have one message, simple message. Be kind every day. Now, last Sunday, the official mother of the Lamb's Club gave us a little story about pumpkins, and she reminded us when we open up the top and look in, it looks kind of yucky in there, you know, lots of seeds and all that, and how to clean it out. Well, this time, I've got the clean pumpkin, but don't try to eat this. This is really not a pumpkin. And I want to talk about what we might want to put back in the pumpkin. However, I'm out of uniform, because I need to put my pumpkin tie on, okay? Oops. There we go. Now I feel right in. I'll wear this on Saturday night so you'll know who I am. Okay. So here are a few things that maybe God wants you to put back in the pumpkin. And I'm going to just pick them up. And, well, look which one came up first. Kindness, to be kind. Okay, that goes, see, the pumpkin's kind of like our heart. So put kindness into your heart. How about this one? Gentleness, gentleness. Okay, and the next one, ooh, we need to have peace. Peace in our heart, but also peace with our neighbors and our friends. We need to have peace. I think we have two more here. Ah, love. When we love each other, we would never hurt each other. We would only be doing the very best that we can for each other. Oop, I'm sorry. There's still two more. Oh, here's one that's kind of hard to do. Obey. That because sometimes we really don't want to do it, but if it's our parents or our teacher or God telling us it's something we should do, let's obey. We'll be very, very happy. Oh, and here's another hard one. To be patient. How many of you are not patient? But patience is a great virtue, and it can be achieved if you let the Holy Spirit lead you in that. So think of the pumpkin. We'll bring this Saturday night when we have our trunk open. Now, by the way, I don't know where it is. Now, I don't want any of the big people to listen to this. Now, tell me what sorts of candy that you'd like to get Saturday night. You won't be there. Well, maybe I could get some and give it to you, you know, next time I see you. What kind of candy do you like? M&M's, anybody? Well, we'll have some good candy because that's a great tradition. But remember, don't eat it all at one time, okay? That's one thing you got to obey your parents when they tell you, not too much at one time. All right, let's sing the Lamb's Club song. I hope none of the big people are disappointed when I say that that's the highlight of the service for me. I love you all, but I also love them. A lot of fun. As we come to our time of prayer, I got a text message that Lisa McLaughlin fell last evening and has broken her ankle. And we'll probably need surgery, but that's going to be decided tomorrow. And also, Diane Mathias advised me that her niece, Chesley Nicole Clements, who is the granddaughter of Dick Bracey, has died. And her funeral service will be tomorrow at 11 at Wright Funeral Home in Franklin. Again, I want to encourage all of you to vote if you want to take advantage of the early voting down at the old Social Services building. That's a no-brainer to go and vote there. And again, thank you for your cooperation with the masks and with maintaining our social distancing. Let's pray together. Almighty and loving God, what a great privilege it is to be invited to stand before you in worship and adoration. You are the great God. You alone are worthy of praise, and you delight as we share the fullness of our hearts with you. Every day, O Lord, maybe even multiple times each day, we all need to confess our sins. We know the right path to take. We know how you would have us live our lives. We know what Jesus taught about loving others and being kind. But so often we do not do that. So often we sink down to the crude and rude level of behavior that we see all about us. And so we ask for your forgiveness, O God, and ask that you would set our feet on the path to righteous living. And Lord, help us to never forget to be thankful. Of course, there are things that we lack in our lives. There are things, sometimes essential things, that we do not have. But when we look over the world and see the many struggles of others, we are very blessed indeed. So may we not forget that. And may we never fail to give you our humble thanks. And as we look over our prayer guide, Lord, we see so many needs, so many who can use the special touch of Jesus for physical or spiritual ailments and guidance, for emotional or mental support. We lift each of these up to you, O God, you who are the great physician. And we will pause just for a moment so that we can each name those for whom we are praying. And as we have been praying these last several weeks, watching the countdown to our national election, continue, O God, to give us a heart to understand each other, to pray for each other, to think and say kind things to and about each other, to recognize the differences between us, and then to respect the opinions of others. And as your Christian people, O Lord, may we lead the way to a kinder and gentler nation whose God is the Lord. Lord Jesus, make haste to come and rescue us. May your will be done in our lives, even as we pray this, in the power of your Holy Spirit, and in the name of your Son and our Savior, even Christ the Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Miriam. The scripture lesson today is taken from Romans, the third chapter, verses 19 through 28. So the judgment of God lies very heavily upon the Jews, for they are responsible to keep God's law instead of doing all these evil things. Not one of them has any excuse. In fact, all the world stands hushed and guilty before Almighty God. Now do you see it? No one can ever be made right in God's sight by doing what the law commands. For the more we know of God's law, the clearer it becomes that we aren't obeying them. His laws serve only to make us see that we are sinners. But now God has shown us a different way to heaven, not by being good enough and trying to keep his laws, but by a new way. Though not new, really, for the scriptures told about it long ago. Now God says he will accept and acquit us, declare us not guilty, if we trust Jesus Christ to take away our sins. And we all can be saved in this same way by coming to Christ, no matter who we are or what we have been like. Yes, all have sinned. All fall short of God's glorious ideal. Yet now God declares us not guilty of offending him if we trust in Jesus Christ, who in his kindness freely takes away our sins. For God sent Jesus Christ to take the punishment for our sins and to end all God's anger against us. He used Christ's blood and our faith as the means of saving us from his wrath. In this way, he was being entirely fair, even though he did not punish those who sinned in former times. For he was looking forward to the time when Christ would come and take away those sins. And now in these days also he can receive sinners in this same way because Jesus took away their sins. But isn't this unfair for God to let criminals go free and say that they are innocent? No, for he does it on the basis of their trust in Jesus, who took away their sins. Then what can we boast about doing to earn our salvation? Nothing at all. Why? Because our acquittal is not based on our good deeds. It is based on what Christ has done and our faith in him. So it is that we are saved by faith in Christ and not by the good things we do. May the Lord bless this reading of his holy word. And to his name be honor and glory. Amen.
Thank you, Beverly. Every year at this time, I take great personal delight in reading and studying about the Reformation of the Church and the great people of God who courageously put their lives in danger to stand for the truth of the gospel. I may have already almost run my dear wife out of our house because every morning I tune in to an app that's on my smartphone, or should I call it my smarter-than-me phone, which is the Ligonier Ministries app. And Dr. R.C. Sproul, who was the founder and teacher in that ministry, is, in my estimation, kind of an expert on the Reformation and in general, and Martin Luther in particular. So that's my radio every morning. So you see, I listen to sermons too. because I think if you should have to, I should, although I think I've got a better preacher than you do, but anyway. The church throughout history has found itself facing times when reform was needed. And we pay tribute to those who, under God's guidance, guided the church to a greater faithfulness to her calling and to her mission. The church in every generation is constantly in a state of reforming itself so that it may stay pure in God's eyes. 503 years ago, on the eve of All Saints' Day, which actually is now corresponds to what we call Halloween, which that word came from the former name of that evening, the 31st day of October, All Hallows' Eve. And you can see how over time that just became Halloween. Now that's a whole nother sermon we could preach, but not today. October 31st, 1517, a young Roman Catholic priest, Dr. Martin Luther, did what any good professor of his day would have done if he wanted to have a debate and a discussion of certain issues. And it was on that date that he posted on the door of the Castle Church in the city of Wittenberg, Germany, a list of 95 topics, or we've come to call them now theses, that he wanted to debate with really whoever would debate him, but in particular, the leaders of the church. Now, at the time, Martin Luther didn't know that what he probably looked at as a simple act of a professor wanting to stir up a debate, after all, isn't that what college is all about, to kind of stir up our mind and get us to think about all sides of issues? And in posting those 95 theses, historians consider that to be kind of the spark plug that ignited a spiritual movement throughout the church. And not just to have all of our attention on Martin Luther, I meant to go through and come up with a law. There were reformers everywhere. John Calvin in Switzerland. They had reformers in England and in other parts of Europe. It was just a time when everyone was taking a look. And what happened on that day in 503 years ago was actually the culmination in his own life of a long personal struggle that he had been wrestling with for many, many years. Because he grew up in a time when the church pictured God as an angry, vindictive God, a God of wrath and punishment who watched over us as if anxiously waiting for that moment that we make a mistake, so that he could punish us even to the point of eternal suffering. The church of that day taught people to fear God in the worst sense of the word. And then the church took that fear in people and used it to control them, to get them to submit to what the church was teaching them and all the rules that the church imposed. And at the same time, that was a very lucrative thing to do. During these years, they were, for one thing, raising money to build St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. Many of you have Vatican City in Rome. Many of you have been there, and it was built from money that was raised during these days. Now, every time I talk about the dark days of a corrupt church, I have to issue a footnote, as it were, to remind me and you that the Catholic Church of Martin Luther's day and the Catholic Church of today are not the same institutions, for they too went through their own Reformation. And so when we speak of the Catholic Church in Martin Luther's day, we are not speaking of the Catholic Church today. And I think it is important that we understand that. Well, as a young man, Martin Luther decided that he did not want to spend all of eternity in hell and suffering. So he set out on a course to make himself pleasing to God. He was a rather good student in law school, and because of a storm one night that almost killed him, it was kind of like an epiphany that he had, and he prayed to Saint Anne, who is the mother of Mary, the mother of Jesus, and said, "If you'll save me, I'll become a monk." He continued his schooling. He was ordained as a priest. He took on the discipline of becoming a monk in the Augustinian order, which still exists today. He earned his doctor of philosophy in Bible and theology, and eventually became a professor of theology at the new University of Wittenberg, which was an upcoming school in Europe at that time. But in spite of all of those accomplishments, at least on the human level, Martin Luther didn't find what he wanted most, what he longed for and searched for, and that was peace with God and a sense of assurance and rest for his troubled spirit. It seemed like no matter how hard he tried to be good and obedient to the commands of God and the church, and no matter how hard he strived to do everything that a Christian was supposed to do, he still felt like he was a sinner in trouble with God. And since God punishes sinners, as he had been taught, he could only see himself as condemned before God. I thought to myself that surely his reasoning may have gone something like this: God is holy and just. I'm a poor, miserable sinner. No matter how hard I try, how can a holy God possibly love a sinner like me? So in spite of doing everything that the church said a person should do to win the mercy and love and forgiveness of God, for Martin Luther, it was absolutely to no avail. Well, to our modern ears, we're probably saying, "Goodness sakes, Martin, you're making too much out of this." Today, we tend to belittle or minimize the whole matter of sin, especially when it's our sin that we're talking about. We act as if it makes no difference to God, or as if God doesn't care what we do. But Martin Luther clearly saw sin for what it was. It was that which separated him from God. Now, throughout all of this personal struggle, Martin Luther was anything but a basket case. He was developing quite a reputation for himself as one of the up-and-coming stars of the church, extremely intelligent and gifted, a great scholar and professor at the university. And by the way, on the front page of your prayer guide, we talk about the first hymn that we sang, the great hymn of the Reformation, A Mighty Fortress, Hymns as Prayer, because to sing is to prayer. One day, as Dr. Luther was preparing for a series of lectures on Paul's letter to the Romans, he read Romans chapter 3, a portion of the Bible that no doubt he had read many times before. But this time, as he read it, his eyes were open and suddenly a light came on. And as he himself described it, it was as though the gates of heaven were opened to me. The words that he read were these: "But now God has shown us a way to be made right with him without keeping the requirements of the law. We are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. God, with undeserved kindness, declares that we are righteous. We don't earn it. People are made right with God when they believe that Jesus sacrificed his life, shedding his blood. And God declares sinners to be right in his sight when they believe in Jesus." And suddenly he knew the truth of the gospel. Being set free from this burden of trying to win over the righteousness of God by his own efforts, he was free simply to rest in the grace of God. Now, we are not saved, we are not put right with God by being good, and we may be good. But that's not what makes us right with God, or obeying the law, or going through any of the outside rituals of religion, even though those are important, or anything else that we may try to do to make ourselves worthy of a life before God. He was brought before a church council in the city of Worms in Germany. He was asked if he would simply recant everything that he had written or spoken. And finally he said, "Well, let me have a day to think about that question, and if it's all right, we could reconvene tomorrow and I'll have your answer." And here was his answer to that council: "Unless I'm convinced by scripture and plain reason, my conscience is captive to the word of God. I cannot and I will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. Here I stand, I cannot do otherwise. God help me. Amen. Whosoever believes in him by faith alone certainly has the ear, the heart of God, and our sins are forgiven." Would you please pray with me? Oh God, thank you for the righteousness that you give us through the merits of your Son, our Lord Jesus. May we rest in the finished work of Christ, who through his own death gives us the righteousness of God, as we pray this in his name. Amen. Although we don't want you to go at the moment, but when you do go, go in the grace and peace of God to love and serve our Savior. You may be seated.